Hello, everyone. Welcome back to this afternoon's sessions. We'll jump right into it. So our first presentation is Meeting Users in Their Spaces, Key Findings on Discovery to Delivery. And Jay Holloway is presenting on behalf of the OCLC team.
Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to our after lunch session. I'm excited to get to be the one to at least get to stand so I'm not falling asleep. So I'll try to keep you awake with me. So welcome to our session, Meeting Users in Their Spaces. My name is Jay Holloway. I'm Senior Product Manager for Delivery Services, where we focus on the end-to-end user experience from discovery all the way through to delivery. So the first thing you'll notice is that I am not on the research team. So I am presenting work on behalf of our wonderful team here that worked on the Discovery and Access Research Project, led by Lynn Conway Salapini, who's our Director for Library Trends within our research group at OCLC. So I was tangentially involved. They used a bunch of log data from WorldCat Discovery. I just touched this, I'm sorry. Yeah, I was given a lot of instruction about how to stand and like use the mic. So I was aware of the problems that they were working on, as well as some of the areas that they were trying to draw data from to understand insights into user behavior within WorldCat Discovery. So looking at the project, we had a few key questions. So we asked, how do academic library users navigate the path from discovery through to access? So there you can see a few key questions. So what do academic users do when they do a search and they don't get results? What differentiates searches that lead to access from those that don't? And in that context, we're looking at, can we derive anything from the search logs that answer that question for us? What demographics, and how does access correlate with success? So does the user have a successful journey if they get access to the material or not? And a fun thing about this project was the mixed methodology that was used. We wanted to understand impact of aggregate user behavior, and that's where the search logs were really helpful, because we could look at thousands of user searches over a period of time. I think we used about a year of data. But we also wanted to understand why. So if anyone has done behavioral analytics before, you know that, oh, it's great, I just found this like really interesting pattern, but why? Why did it happen? What were they actually doing on the other side of the screen? So this method combined both the user logs with actual user interviews to understand the why behind the search session. So it went something like this. The user would say, hey, I'm interested in a $20 Amazon gift card. And so they signed up with us and we said, okay, next time you do a search in WorldCat Discovery, there's a little code at the bottom of the screen. Go ahead and copy and paste that for us and send that to us. And then we'll schedule an interview with you. And the interview was, I think, about a half hour long. And before that, we would look at their search session to see what we thought their search looked like. So we got some ideas for what we thought they did, and then we talked to them to see what they actually did and what their actual behavior was, how they felt the search session went. In addition to that, we also then talked to a bunch of resource sharing librarians like yourselves, did a bunch of interviews to understand on the fulfillment side, once the request is made from the user, what did that look like and what problems were librarians seeing, which informed an overall holistic picture. So I'm going to briefly cover a few of the high-level findings that we had that are within the paper. So if you're interested in those, we can dig into them there, but then also share with you some of the data analysis and findings that we had as a kind of a complement to that research. So the first theme is that users expect intuitive experiences. So I love this quote, convenience is king, queen, the whole court. So intuitive experiences are an expectation for modern search experiences, for modern UIs. Users bring with them all of the expectations that they've built along their journeys through Amazon, through Facebook, Twitter, all of those different applications. They bring those expectations to them even into the library catalog. And traditional library catalogs are difficult to use. They're not intuitive. They are not built for the user to understand. They rely on a high degree of domain expertise. And so those are problems that we think a lot about, especially myself, with WorldCat Discovery, and how do we make sure that users understand the value of the library data that is so carefully curated. The next key theme is that the experiences need to be smart. And we're using the word smart here intentionally from a report that the Big Ten Academic Alliance produced on smart fulfillment. And this is where we believe that context and situation matter to the user's search experience. So in one scenario, maybe speed is the most important thing, and the user will prefer to purchase something from Amazon over waiting for an ILL request to go through. In other cases, maybe a long tail scenario where the material is rare or difficult to obtain or very expensive, the user is willing to wait the time. And we need to be able to optimize for both types of experiences on behalf of the user and not expose any of that complexity. You know, you are working in multiple systems in the back end, but the end user shouldn't have to understand that you're working in multiple systems on the front end when they're making the request. They just want to know, how quickly can I get it? Am I likely to get the thing? And is there a cost to me to do that? The next theme is around personal experiences. So and a key piece here was we asked this question in the interviews, what about the search delighted you? And I love that word delight, because that is an aim that we have for our system, is to not just do what's expected and, you know, kind of check the box, but to actually delight, inspire users to continue their research. And we found that just while all of the searchers successfully completed their journey, they were actually pretty satisfied with the experience, they weren't delighted by it. So we asked, like, what would delight you? And they, on reflection, would say things like, well, I guess when the system does something that I wasn't really expecting it to do, that would delight me. Like, if it provided some value I wasn't expecting for the system to be able to produce, that's a delightful experience. So surprise delights users, not just accomplishing the task. And the last of our four themes is access to a universal inventory. So share and share alike. So this group of you in front of me have pioneered the way for resource sharing. And it's predicated on this fact that we have access to a massive inventory from our shared collections and our shared databases. So with this metadata, we're able to actually get users that get materials in front of users that they don't have direct access to immediately or locally, and get that either through your group or through libraries worldwide. So these four themes together, this research is very exciting for us in the delivery services area, because that is directly informing our direction and roadmap for how we're trying to build and understand our products. So intuitive experiences that are smart, that take context and personal experiences into account, we aim to delight users with them, and is built on a massive inventory of both local, group, and worldwide collections. And that, in summation, is what we are thinking of as the library on demand. So bringing experiences to the user on demand where they're at, not expecting the user to come to us to solve their problem. So that is kind of the high-level overview that includes the interviews, the log analysis, and the ILL resource sharing library and interviews, all kind of aggregated together. So then I want to dig down a little bit deeper into some of the actual data. I love this part. So looking at the log analysis that we did, share some key insights with you there. So this is what a raw log looked like. It wasn't the most beautiful thing in the world. We didn't engineer the system to answer these questions right out of the box for us, so it took a little bit of digging to figure out what could we actually learn from this system. So just a few examples of things that we could learn. So one of those questions was, what can we learn from the search logs? This particular user did a keyword search but mistyped it, so they had zero results. The second is that they redid a keyword search with the correct spelling and got about 800,000 results. So with a small typo, they went from 0 to 800,000 or so results. They began typing in additional keywords, so they refined the search a little bit. And they actually selected an auto suggestion from a dropdown, which dramatically reduced the recall to about 2,000 results. So we can tell quite a bit about that search just looking at the log. Also looking at the trends in aggregate, we noticed a few kind of pervasive behaviors. The first was that users would correct searches. So that scenario where they mistyped something and then corrected it. We labeled those as anything that had a 90% or greater similarity to the previous search were categorized into that bucket. And that had a pretty good accuracy. The second was search refinements. So this is where they don't change the core phrase of the search, but they add a few words afterwards or before to further refine an existing search that they did. And that is where searches had about an 80 to 90% similarity to the previous query that was run. And the last was just a new search. So they searched for something, decided, I want to go down a different direction, and did another search. And that is where searches had less than an 80% similarity with the previous search string. So in summary, looking at the aggregate view, searches had an average of 2 searches per session. So while the user was sitting there with the browser open and the search hadn't timed out yet, so I think that's about an hour in discovery. They lasted 5 minutes per session. They did about 2 searches, and they were each about 5 words long. 12% of the sessions had search refinements, so that's where they were an 80% to 90% similarity, and 33% of the sessions had multiple searches. Then within the types of requests that are made, those were all kind of search statistics. On the fulfillment side, trying to understand, did the user actually get what they wanted, what they came for? We group these into a few different types of requests. So we talked about search results, where a search was made and then another search was done right after that search. So they weren't trying to get fulfillment yet. They were still refining the search or doing new searches. The next one is physical access options, where we were able to indicate that the material is held by either the local institution that the user was at or by a group within the institution's configuration. The next is online access, so just e-links, of all the types of e-links that are provided in a discovery system. Some attempt to save is the next type, or export the citation. So either you can either save it to a list or export it out into a citation manager, or a physical access attempt. So the user made a request on a fulfillment button to place a hold with your local circulation or through your group fulfillment scenario, like maybe relay D2D or some group like that. So looking at those types of events, so we just kind of categorize the different types of search events. These are the ways that users ended their sessions. So the first line is looking at all click events, where 54% of them did another search after their previous search. About 20% had some sort of physical access option available. And this is a limitation of looking at just the logs, where we know that maybe they could have seen the held by statement or they saw the con number, but we don't know if they actually then went to get the thing. So that's a limitation of just looking at the logs. About 15% attempted a full text link, and so on. Then what's interesting is comparing that to the last request made. So the first is just in total, like what was done in for every type of search. The second is just looking at what is the last thing that the user did. So where did they end their session? So in that, you can see that the numbers change a little bit in interesting ways. So less of those ended in another search, which kind of makes sense. Like you hopefully found something that you were looking for and didn't do another search right after that. The physical access remained about the same, but you can see that the online access attempt doubled from 15% to 30%, or about 16 to 30%, which means that more sessions ended in a clicking on some type of full text link than they than other options. So during the session, maybe you clicked on a full text link, but you were more likely, twice as likely, to end your session clicking on full text link. It's kind of an interesting insight. Another fun model was looking at the probability of fulfillment based on the type of search that users did. So we're trying to figure out, can we guess that a user was likely to get end in fulfillment based on their search behavior. So you can see on the left, this is kind of a basic search. There were no limiters applied. In this scenario, there were only even two words per search. And the chance of fulfillment there was about 70%. So the likelihood that a user would have ended in fulfillment, so they saw a physical fulfillment option or they clicked on one, was 70%. Then looking to the right, looking at that bottom one, actually, just increasing the number of words that you did in the search increased the fulfillment a little bit, so about 1%, so not that interesting. But adding an author limiter pushed it up about 15% to 85% chance of ending in fulfillment. So by refining the search using the author limiter, the user had a much more likely chance to end in fulfillment than they did without it, which is interesting. So that's kind of some of the fun data behind the scenes that informed the high-level findings that we had within the paper. And the next piece is the user interviews. So some of the questions that we asked here are, you know, tell us what you're looking for and why. You know, did the item you were searching for come up in the search results? And, you know, did you find it? And we talked about this delight question too. So were you delighted with the search? So on the left, we had that search session that was pretty interesting and involved, where there was zero searches because they mistyped, and then they got a bunch of searches, and then they refined it a little bit more, and they narrowed the search results quite a bit. So that's what the log told us. But on the right, we were able to get even more context. So the user was just starting work on a paper on a very broad topic, and they didn't know much about it. They were really overwhelmed by the number of search results when they made that search correction and fixed the typing. So they actually abandoned discovery to go do some more searching because they realized, I don't know enough about this topic. I need to go figure out more refined topics to search. They did that, came back to the library search, and found the thing that they needed. And because they received some help from student workers, and they also had some library instruction in the past, they felt confident that they were doing that they were performing the task correctly. So I think that insight that I should abandon search and go to Google was probably some of that interjection from their previous search classes. So that was just one example of the types of insights that we could derive, you know, adding the logs plus the contextual analysis. So looking at this methodology, it's quite a bit of work to do both the log analysis and the user interviews. So some of the challenges were just that it was resource intensive. So it was quite time consuming to do both the log analysis and then take that log analysis and figure out, okay, what was the user doing in the user interview, recruiting for them, and et cetera. It took multiple team members, different areas of expertise to do this. It wasn't a capability that just one person had in our organization. And we also had to go through multiple institutional review boards, which might be part of the reason I'm not on the paper. and it required a high level of expertise. So I consulted to help, you know, describe what some of these scenarios were, just with my product knowledge, you know, that type of thing. And finally, benefits. We got great context using the qualitative and combined quantitative data, and found that these things are most effective when there's some type of digital trace that the user performed an action. So that scenario where we said, you know, the user could see that there was a holding, but we don't know if the user acted on that because there wasn't a click associated with it. It's harder to determine those sort of actions when you don't have a digital trace that the action was performed. And finally, we are excited to just have a new way to collaborate with our research partners. We're going to do some, as we look at new ways to do analytics, we're going to improve some of the ways that we can do this so we could potentially do it much faster and a little bit lighter weight. And this definitely influenced the product and system development that we have, which is always exciting to see research in action. So thank you. That's all I've got.
Other questions for Jay?
So I just wanted to know how much time passed between when the users interacted with the system from to then doing the interview with them.
It was a few weeks. So in some cases, we actually needed to remind the user what they did. So we're like, do you remember when you did the search query? And they did, though, because it was kind of a unique thing where they knew they were sending us the session ID. So I think there was some additional awareness that you wouldn't typically have if you were just doing a search in the system.
Do you think that the process would have yielded some different results, or maybe more poignant results if it had been done in a quicker turnaround time?
It's certainly possible. Yeah, and that's kind of one of the questions. Like, is there something that you could do more in the moment that would be close to this as well? Could you just get immediate feedback from the system if you trigger certain journeys that we're really interested in?
Thank you.
I would like to ask you, how many users you interviewed? You didn't tell us the number.
Yes, it's in the paper, but I think it was 14 users were interviewed, give or take. Don't quote me on that.
And another question, how did you analyze your data from the interviews?
From the qualitative data, yeah. It was coded with themes, and then the themes were analyzed.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah,
thank
sure. You. Thanks for the question.
Now, I just want to ask you, you've got some really interesting insights from your data there. I was wondering, you mentioned that you used it for, this being used for development. Mm-hmm. What kind of things have you managed to produce because of what you found?
So right now it's primarily influencing our strategy for our products. So I referenced Smart Fulfillment. That is a project that we're currently sizing out and slicing out into kind of deliverable chunks. So that's one very tangible way that we're trying to improve the experience, is to promote the likely best fulfillment option to the user rather than them having to choose between a bunch of different ones.
Can you clarify, and forgive me if I missed this, but were they only undergrads, or what type of users?
Yes, I believe they were primarily undergraduate students, but I think there were a few graduate and other more experienced researchers in the group.
Sure. All right. Thank you very much, Jay.
Our next presentation is In Transit Practices in Multi-Campus University Libraries in Turkey. And presenting this is Sami Chuhadar and Abdullah Turan.
Thank you very much, Dina. Dear participants, dear colleagues, I want to begin by thanking the organization committee for their warm welcome and great organization. Our topic is In Transit Practices Among Multi-Campus University Libraries in Turkey. We prepared this paper with Ertuğrul Çimen and Sami. We will be talking about resource sharing, the document of in-transit services, Turkish higher education, a survey on in-transit services, and the case of Istanbul Bilgi University Library. Nowadays, research data management, user experience, open access, big data, and robots are some of the trend topics in libraries. However, collaboration and resource sharing are forever topic for libraries. Academic libraries began sharing information, resources, and experiences with one another almost as soon as they were established and today. Cooperation and resource sharing are increasingly critical for libraries due to changing user needs, diversification of types of users, technological development, limited funding for library collection. Although the format and the methods of resource sharing have changed, the principle of resource sharing remains as one of the most important areas of cooperation for academic libraries. Electronic collections of academic libraries have grown rapidly, which has encouraged libraries and software experts to develop creative applications such as resource electronic document sharing. While the use of electronic resources has increased and access to these resources has become easier, the sharing of print materials remains important. Many ILL management systems include document supply modules. However, document supply can also be provided using well-known standalone products such as Arial, Prospero, and Odyssey. As far as the resource sharing in Turkey, we have a special collaboration working group under the Anatolian University Libraries Consortium. We have interlibrary collaboration tracking system that allows academic libraries to submit their loan requests via the platform. Approximately 200,000 print and electronic resources were shared through the platform in the last 10 years. What about sharing resources among campuses? There are several terms to explain resources sharing among campuses, like in transit, on-campus delivery, campus mail service, on-site borrowing, intra-campus service, and so on. We prefer to use for this service as in transit. In transit services are library services offered at academic institutions operating on more than one campus. Library resources which are available in another campus can be requested via this service. In transit services are general carried out by libraries, resource sharing and document supply or reference departments. Before finishing my speech, I would like to mention one more topic, that is internet access. Even though North America, Europe, Australia have been adapting easily to technological development and focusing on creative solutions, the internet access rate is 49% in some Asian and many African countries. They represent 72% of the world's population. This means that, according to these statistics, 43% of the population does not yet have internet access, which means almost half of the world's population has to rely on traditional resource sharing methods. Now, Sami will continue the presentation covering the survey and results details.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Abdullah, for giving information about resource sharing and intranet services. Before giving detailed information about the survey and the case of Istanbul Big University Library, I would like to give brief background information about Turkish higher education systems and structure. There are 207 seven universities, including 129 state and 78 foundation universities in Turkey. And also, there are about 7 million potential library users in Turkey. According to Turkish Statistical Institute, there are 589 university libraries in Turkey with 17.6 million print items in their collection. When the total number of books is divided by the number of the users and academics, there are 2.2 books per users. It can be said that the number of the publication per use is low. In this context, effective use of sharing information resources become more important due to low number of the resources. Secondly, higher education activities are provided in provinces and districts. For example, a university has 67 undergraduate and 28 associate diploma programs. 27 of these programs are taught on campuses in the districts. Most of the university libraries are located on the central campuses. The resources offered to students and central campuses should also be provided to users in other districts, at least and in transit services. In this context, a survey was designed to initially identify the university that operate with more than one campus to discover if their campuses have libraries. It also aims to gain insight into impact of the in-transit services on library budget, use of physical space and user satisfaction, as well as librarians' opinion and suggestions regarding in-transit services. Now, I would like to share with you a highlight of the survey. If you would like to get more detailed information about our research, you may read our paper in the conference books. You may get more detail about the workflow and other informations. The survey consists of 14 questions and the participation rate was 16%. As shown on the screen, that 19% of universities have only one campus, 81% of universities have more than one campus. Majority of the universities conduct the teaching and research activities in more than one campuses. As for the libraries, 18% of the universities have only one library. 62% of universities have 2 to 5 libraries, and 5% of universities have more than 16 libraries. 23% of the universities that have more than one campus have no in-transit services between campuses. However, 47% of the universities have in-transit services. What kind of the materials were transparent among the libraries? It is interesting to be observed that 23% of the in-transit transactions were non-book materials like DVDs or other materials. As shown on the screen, 49% of transactions of the materials sent via in-transit services were books, and 26% were journals and articles. It is important to deliver requested materials via in-transit services user as soon as possible. In this context, another question of the survey focused on frequency of inter-campus delivery systems. 83% of the respondents state that they were transferring material at the frequencies different from the ones specified in the survey. When the details are examined, 85% of this group state that when the requested items is occurs, the requested item sent to user. How the materials were transferring among the libraries? 83% of materials were sent by the university vehicles. Also, we asked in another question to the user, to the librarians, are there any items in the library budget that are designated for the in-transit services? According to survey result, 94% participants state that there was no special budget in for this service in the library budget. It is important to know that if a system was used to collect data and get user in-transit statistics, it is shown that 48% use live automation systems and 36% use email for facilitating in-transit service transactions. It is good to learn that all type of library users benefited from the in-transit services. Faculty members are the greatest proportion of in-transit usage with 23%, while associate diploma students are the smallest group with 13%. As you know, there is a motto, keep calm and ask a librarian. So we would like to know librarians' opinion about in-transit services, whether they have or not. According to survey result, 82% of librarians state that these services have a positive impact on library budget. All the librarians state that such a service have a positive effect on user satisfaction. 92% of librarians state that in-transit services have a positive impact on efficient use of physical spaces in the library. And 95% noted such a service prevent purchasing multiple copies of the materials. 90% reported a positive impact of the efficient use of library personnel time, spending on cataloging, classification, and technical services. Up to now, we try to give a broad picture about in-transit services in Turkey. In order to further examine such a service and support or analysis with numerical data, BG Libraries in-transit services was also included. Because we have long-term experience in providing in-transit services and access to application data from library automation system. Let me share brief information about Istanbul BG University and library. Istanbul BG University was founded as a private non-profit institution in 1996. Has 3 campuses and approximately 20,000 students. As for the libraries, we have 170,000 print resources, 450,000 electronic books, 62,000 journals, 125 databases, and other academic materials. BG Library, why we established in-transit services Istanbul BG University Libraries? Because increasing number of the campuses are located in different districts, effective use of the library spaces, and also moving the department's different campuses frequently. In order to evaluate the impact of the in-transit services, BG Library, in terms of budget, physical space, and the collection, we analyzed data obtained from the library automation system between 2009 and 2018. As shown in the figure, more than 35,000 items delivered to users through in-transit services among three libraries during the 10-year period. 85% of the delivered materials were books, 15% were DVDs, journals, music CDs, and other items. In-transit services have had a positive contribution to use efficient library spaces. When BG Library's in-transit data is evaluated, it is seen that an area approximately 100 square meters and 120 double-sided bookshelves would be needed if we don't have an in-transit system. The number of the items sent between three libraries within 10 years is shown in the, on the screen. Although the collection located according to programs taught in the campuses, many items requested from other campus libraries. For example, most of the library users request books related language and literature, novels, similar books. Before finishing my presentation, I will mention about the effect of in-transit services on library budget by preventing reacquisition of the same item for multiple campuses. As you see in the table, we have saved $1,490,000. This service didn't require any additional staff budget cargo expenses. We only purchased 10 book carrying cases in order to protect materials while being sent among campuses. Library resources deliveries have been a part of internal cargo system at the university that enabled to transfer documents between campuses. In conclusion, in-transit services are important for libraries because in-transit services have service contribute positively to the university library budget, have a positive impact of user satisfaction, have libraries use physical spaces, prevent to purchase multiple copies of the item, help the library staff use their time efficiently. If multiple copies of these resources had been purchased, more staff time would have been reserved for operations such as cataloging, purchasing, classification, processing, etc. In summary, most of the universities have more than one campus in Turkey. Although only 47% of the universities that have more than one campus have in-transit services between campuses. Universities with multiple campuses has a standard service, provide their users with materials from other universities under interlibrary loan programs. However, they shouldn't forget in-transit service as well. Thank you for listening to us and interest.
I believe we have time for a question or two, if someone has one.
Hey, I was just curious, when you were discussing the vehicles that are used, it sounded like it was mostly university-owned vehicles that are used for the in-transit. Did you have a sense for why that is, as opposed to a private contractor or something like FedEx or UPS? Or was it just the statistics that were gathered? Thanks.
Actually, according to survey, university cars used for these services, because just only 47% of the universities have this system. It is very new, so we are trying to establish a well-known system for Turkey. So university car, the most used system for cargo and delivering systems. Thank you.
Okay. Do you also share resources with the public library around Turkey?
Okay. Yes. For the, you said public library, right? Yeah. Public library. Yes, you can request items. Any library. Sorry, you may take out the books any city, any library, but you cannot return. So this year it is just started. So you may request an item to another city. You can borrow it. Yeah, public libraries just started this year.
What is the timeline between the transit time between one library to another?
Yeah, thank you for the questions. User behavior changing very fast. So for my university, within a day, two times the cars turn. So if they request it until noon, the items come the same day. But if the items requested after 3 p.m., the following day is the items available in the library.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
And our final presentation for this session is International Interlibrary Loan in a Changing Environment, results from the 2019 RUSA STARS International ILL Survey. And Hillary Thompson will be our presenter.
Great. Good afternoon, everyone. So my co-author, Kurt Munson, and I have been studying international interlibrary loan together since 2014. This research has been conducted as part of the ALA RUSA STARS International Interlibrary Loan Committee. And for those of you who may not be familiar with these many acronyms, ALA stands for the American Library Association. It's a large organization with 11 divisions. One of those divisions is the Reference and User Services Association, or RUSA. RUSA, in turn, has a number of sections, including the Sharing and Transforming Access to Resources section, which is also known as STARS, and many resource-sharing practitioners in North America participate in this section. And the International Interlibrary Loan Committee is a part of STARS. Part of the committee's charge is to evaluate trends in international resource sharing. And to this end, the committee has conducted 4 surveys over the past 12 years, inquiring about libraries' international borrowing and lending practices. The 2019 survey is the 3rd iteration to target a global audience, and the first one to offer multiple translations of the survey in the hope of increasing the diversity of respondents. Before delving into the details of the 2019 survey, I would like to recognize all of the committee members who contributed to this project. As you can see, it's a multi-year process involving numerous contributors at every stage. So we'll start by sort of briefly looking at the survey itself, its translation, distribution, and demographics. The survey was comprised of 40 questions divided into 4 sections about your library, borrowing activity, lending activity, and some broader open response questions. The 2019 survey built upon the 2015 and 2011 instruments reusing most of those questions, but we did add some new open response questions that delve deeper into how libraries can improve this service for our users. 6 language options were provided. We recruited bilingual volunteers who reviewed translations generated by Google Translate and supplied corrections, which were minor for French, German, and Spanish, but rather extensive for Arabic and Russian. Our original goal was to offer the survey in all 7 of the official IFLA languages, but unfortunately, we were unable to find someone to review the Chinese translation within the time allotted. The survey ran throughout the month of March and early April, and during this time, the committee sent more than 370 emails to resource-sharing listservs, networks, and professional contacts across about 100 countries. Members of IFLA's Document Delivery and Resource-Sharing section and the regional office managers were also asked to distribute this to their networks. And altogether, we received 395 responses, and 65 countries were represented, which is the highest number for RUSA STARS International ILL Survey to date. Europe and North America did provide the most respondents, representing 39% and 33% of our responses overall. And university libraries also dominated, both overall and on most continents. Here you can see a breakdown of responses by country. Shades of blue indicate that we received one or more responses from a particular country. The darker the blue, the more responses. And the countries with the highest number of responses are, in order, the United States, Italy, Canada, Spain, Germany, Australia, Brazil, Kenya, South Africa, and the United Kingdom, each of which had 10 or more responses. While 80% of the respondents used the English version of the survey, the data does suggest that providing translations increased the geographic diversity overall. Each translation was used at least twice, with Spanish being used the most. And most notably, 8 countries that had not been featured in either the 2011 or the 2015 survey did answer the 2019 version using one of the translations. So in our opinion, this was a valuable enhancement for this iteration and one that should be continued going forward. Oops. All right, so moving on now to considering borrowing and a brief overview of what we learned about international borrowing. So the majority of respondents do borrow internationally, including both returnable and non-returnable materials from other countries. Overall, the volume of international borrowing remains low, with the majority of respondents reporting less than 100 items per year for both returnable and non-returnable materials. Participation in international borrowing does vary by continent, with European respondents being the most likely to participate, and African respondents the least likely. Among those who do not borrow from libraries abroad, the most common reasons were no demand, lack of infrastructure, and cost. The 2019 survey revealed no clear trend across the board in terms of international borrowing volume in recent years, but among those who did report an increase, the most common reasons were change in users discovering international materials and change in the availability of international lenders. Among those reporting a decrease in volume, the most common reason was alternatives such as Sci-Hub, ICANN-HAS PDF, or ResearchGate, which we've already heard about earlier at this conference. So when asked from which countries does your library borrow most heavily, about 250 respondents identified 57 countries as frequent lenders, and you can see the top ones overall listed here. For the first time this year, we asked why does your library borrow frequently from these countries? And there were clear patterns in proximity or language, which is something we had noticed in the prior surveys. But actually, those were mentioned far less frequently as reasons for borrowing. Instead, the top reasons were availability of materials, the ease of conducting international interlibrary loan with those libraries, and the overall reliability of the service. No matter where in the world one might be, certain types of materials remain more difficult than others to acquire from foreign collections. The most difficult are rare older materials, with half of the respondents who borrow internationally reporting difficulty, followed by ebooks, and then closely by theses and dissertations. Overall, books and musical scores remain the easiest formats to borrow from abroad, with less than 20% reporting difficulty with these materials. Okay, so moving on now to an overview of lending activity. And this lending activity actually looks in many ways a lot like borrowing. We have a similar number of those lending internationally. They're doing so at similar volumes. And we also, in many cases, have some variants that looks very similar by continent as well. Among those reasons for libraries not lending abroad, we see the same no demand, lack of infrastructure and cost, but we also see local policy, which is perhaps more so than the others, things that we can actually change. And the 2019 survey, again, no clear change in terms of the volume, but where libraries did report an increase, the most common reason was change in the availability of holdings information, followed by change in local policies. Among those reporting a decrease in international lending volume, again, we see change in availability of holdings information, followed here by a change in licensing terms. It's notable that holdings information is the top reason for both growth and decline. This really illustrates the critical role that discovery plays in either facilitating or impeding resource sharing. The ability to effectively lend non-returnables to other countries depends on electronic delivery methods, copyright law, and in the case of e-resources, licensing terms. Of the respondents that lend non-returnables abroad, 84% deliver those materials electronically. Those that do not provide electronic delivery are primarily located in Asia and Europe, in particular in Germany, Italy, and Japan. Despite the wide popularity of electronic delivery, both copyright law and licensing restrictions remain significant barriers to lending non-returnables abroad, affecting approximately half of the respondents' ability to lend copies. The 2019 survey also asked respondents about preferred methods for lending abroad. Email remains the dominant form of accepting international requests, followed by resource sharing systems or networks. Expedited postal service is the most common method of shipping returnables abroad, closely followed by regular postal service and couriers. When it comes to payment, IFLA vouchers are the most widely accepted method for international transactions. And IFLA vouchers are in fact common across nearly all continents, but when it comes to payment methods, we actually see extremely wide variety by region. Right. So the similarities between the 2011, 2015, and 2019 surveys allow for longitudinal comparison of the three data sets. Overall, participation in international interlibrary loan, along with the characteristics and the methods used, have remained relatively constant over the past decade. Most changes are minor, likely reflecting a gradual evolution in services and operations. So what we've chosen to highlight here are notable changes in 2019, as well as clear trends that you can see across all three of the surveys. In terms of request methods accepted by lenders, locally hosted web forms are on the rise, while perhaps unsurprisingly, fax and postal service have experienced sharp decreases amongst our respondents. For payment methods, acceptance of IFLA vouchers increased significantly, as did bank transfers to a lesser degree. During the same time period, acceptance of both local and foreign checks declined. And essentially what we see here is an increase in electronic payment methods and a decrease in non-electronic payment methods, with IFLA vouchers standing apart as the notable exception. For delivery of returnable materials abroad, the surveys demonstrate sustained growth in the use of courier shipping. While expedited postal service remains the most common shipping method, it is no longer employed by the majority of respondents as it was in 2011 and 2015. Licensing terms of electronic resources also appear to be an increasing barrier to international interlibrary loan. The 2019 survey was the first to separate licensing from copyright when asking about potential barriers. And when licensing was coupled with copyright, 42 and 46% of respondents indicated that either or both were a barrier. When we broke it out in 2019, that percentage rose to 55%, which is an increase of at least 9 percentage points, possibly more, depending on how much copyright played a role previously. Similarly, ebooks rose to second place in 2019 among the hardest materials to obtain from foreign libraries, surpassing theses and dissertations for the first time. So again, licensing really emerging as a barrier here. So, you know, considering from all of the data that we looked at, both the quantitative as well as the open responses, we really tried to glean challenges to international resource sharing and strategies that our respondents revealed for us to overcome these barriers. So things really kind of, you know, begin with discovery. This can be a challenge with interlibrary loan in general, but especially with international interlibrary loan. And suggestions from respondents include broader adoption. So suggestions include the desire for a shared global catalog, as well as more international holdings in WorldCat. Came up, both of these frequently when they were asked about what would make international interlibrary loan easier for your library, which is really appears to be a response to the proliferation of topical databases, of digital repositories, of national catalogs, of all of the many places that you can search. So there's this desire to look in one place and find all of these holdings. Alternately, a search engine that would allow searching across linked national catalogs or better exposure of the content of catalogs and repositories to Google could also be a solution here. So once an owning library is identified, the next challenge can be determining how to request that item from the library, especially if they fall outside of one of your networks. Again, suggestions from respondents included broader adoption of WorldShare Interlibrary Loan and wider acceptance of email requests. Alternately, fuller adoption and vendor implementation of international standards, such as the new ISO 18626 standard, could be a solution here by allowing requests and responses to pass from one system to another. Project ReShare is developing an open source ILL platform to demonstrate this type of interoperability, and we'll be learning more about that project tomorrow. When it comes to improving fulfillment of international requests, a number of challenges to lending abroad exist. Some formats, again, remain more difficult to borrow than others, so rethinking policies and service models could expand global access. In particular, when we're thinking about lending older or rare materials, if we want to reduce the risk of those materials, digitization on demand, if items are in the public domain, or controlled digital lending for materials that are still copyright protected, are both potential solutions worth pursuing. We had respondents to our survey that addressed both of those options, and we also heard from the University of Alberta yesterday about the work they're trying to do with controlled digital lending. Speed is also a concern for respondents, and where there are no legal impediments, electronic delivery appears to be really, truly the most effective solution for expediting fulfillment of requests. 18 respondents cited electronic delivery as a reason that their international lending volume had increased over the past 5 years, and it is a factor in determining the countries from which a library chooses to borrow. And then 19 respondents also expressed the need for consistent procedures for clearing or bypassing customs, including this very intriguing suggestion of developing an internationally known and accepted symbol, note, or sticker that declares parcels containing library books. Finally, fulfillment could be improved by education and advocacy related to copyright and e-resource licensing. The survey responses indicate varying interpretations of copyright law within individual countries, with respondents from 18 countries supplying inconsistent responses to the question, do copyright restrictions prevent you from supplying non-returnables to international borrowers? Similarly, numerous respondents expressed uncertainty as to whether copyright law or licensing prevented them from supplying non-returnables abroad. Better understanding of both copyright and licensing could help reduce denials stemming from uncertainty or misunderstanding. And as copyright law varies by country, national libraries and national library associations are perhaps best suited to advance copyright education, while library consortia may be better positioned to negotiate more favorable licensing terms for their members, as we've heard from other speakers over the past few days. And then finally, that brings us to payment. So 93% of respondents who lend materials abroad charge for the service. And with this in mind, an easy payment method becomes essential to effective international interlibrary loan. One of the most common answers to the question, have you undertaken efforts to improve or expand international interlibrary loan, was making changes related to payment, including using IFLA vouchers and accepting multiple methods. Likewise, payment emerged as the most frequent response to the question, what would make international interlibrary loan easier? And 40% of respondents gave us suggestions related to payment. We also added a new question in 2019 asking libraries if they would accept electronic IFLA vouchers in order to gauge the popularity of this idea, which we've heard in several corners. And 70% of respondents confirmed that they would use electronic IFLA vouchers. 60% of those already use IFLA vouchers, but 10% would start using IFLA vouchers if an electronic version existed. Given the wide support for this proposal, we recommend that the IFLA document delivery and resource sharing section explore the feasibility of electronic IFLA vouchers as a supplement to the plastic ones. Because again, actually not everyone here indicated that they would use the electronic version. So wrapping up here, we believe it's clear from the survey results that international interlibrary loan continues to play a small yet vital role in meeting academic library users' information needs within an increasingly complex discovery and delivery ecosystem. Discovery of global resources continues to present challenges, both old and new. Delivery, on the other hand, though, does appear to be moving away in some cases from siloed systems that only support sharing within one particular network towards what we hope is a future where systems are better able to communicate with one another. We find that the potential to connect diverse interlibrary loan networks from around the world to be an especially exciting one. And we believe that ILL practitioners must actively participate in shaping this evolving landscape to ensure that future systems support more robust international collaboration and continued improvement of services. Again, many of the changes in 2019 from what the prior RusaStar surveys reported are promising, in particular the increasing usage of electronic methods, as well as wider acceptance of IFLA vouchers. All of this should make international interlibrary loan easier for both borrowing and lending libraries. We must continue to build upon these successes by seeking ways to eliminate the remaining barriers to sharing resources across borders. That means addressing licensing terms, governing e-resources, and renegotiating those. Likewise, we need to explore creative solutions for lending older and rare materials in collaboration with those responsible for their access and preservation. We've identified, I think, at least two potential projects for the IFLA document delivery and resourcing section to explore thinking about those electronic IFLA vouchers and that library books no commercial value standard sticker. And solutions to these shared challenges really can and should be pursued at various levels, both the local, consortial, national, and hopefully international. So in short, we'd really hope that we continue to partner and advocate at all levels for the means necessary to better serve our patrons. And I think the presentations here have been really inspiring already about the efforts to do that. So that really concludes our presentation. I'll just mention that if anyone is interested in helping with future versions, if you'd want to help share the survey or even review a translation, we do have a very short online form that we'd like to ask folks to fill out.
All right, are there any questions? We have time for maybe one.
Thanks for a nice presentation. It resonates well with what we are working on cooperation and collaboration. I wanted to know whether also in terms of accessibility, discoverability, findability, and shareability of information, whether you experience such technological problems like link rot, whereby hyperlinks or web pointers have changed, and then or they give pointers to content that is no longer available, or maybe has changed due to some technical configurations.
Yeah. So I think that's a really great example of the complexity of the discovery environment in which we find ourselves. Having more options to search more content online, this is wonderful. When we're able to find something online, we can immediately connect our user to that. That's faster delivery, that's wonderful, but it does bring additional challenges. That's searching, that's what happens when you find a link to something published online that no longer exists or that has the link rot you described. So I think that's one of the challenges that we're continuing to see, and I would hope those of our colleagues working in metadata and more that technical side of things will be able to partner, whether it's with search engines, publishers, others providing these things to help improve that, because it does absolutely affect what we do in resource sharing, especially as we rely more on Google and some of these other services.